Studies showed that trained raters were more accurate than untrained raters. Content of appraiser training. Researchers distinguish between training in the mechanics and dynamics of performance appraisal. Training in the mechanics of the performance management system includes the use of performance appraisal forms. Training in the dynamics of performance appraisal includes the establishment and communication of performance standards, writing clear and measurable objectives, interpersonal skills, conflict management, rating errors, observation and measurement of performance, giving feedback, and a performance appraisal interview. Topics that could be included in the training are shown in Focus Box 11.4. Focus 11.4, Content of Appraiser Training. The underlying management philosophy of the system. The underlying values of the system. Techniques used in the system. Negotiation of goals and communication of standards. Human relations aspects. Preparation of employees for performance appraisal. Handling of performance appraisal problems. Feedback interviews. Discussing low performance with workers. Observing and recording skills and rating errors. Performance dimensions and standards. Linking performance with rewards. Administrative aspects. Performance feedback. Appraisers must learn that ongoing feedback is the most important factor in maintaining or improving employee performance. The supervisor has the opportunity to observe the employee's performance, discuss that performance, and, if necessary, help the employee to improve that performance. Rating errors. Appraiser bias is regarded as one of the problems associated with performance appraisal. Latham and Mann summarized some of the recent research findings regarding appraiser bias as follows. A. Ratings were a stronger reflection of raters' overall biases than true performance factors. B. Supervisors' positive regard for subordinates results in leniency and halo errors, and less inclination to punish poor performance. C. Gender and race bias play a role when ratings are made. Men are rated as more effective than women. Blacks and Asians are rated as less effective than whites. Rating errors reduce the liability, validity, and utility of the performance appraisal system. Therefore, raters should be aware of rating errors. The most common appraiser errors are reported in Focus Box 11.5. Focus 11.5. The most common rating errors. Halo effect. An extremely good or poor rating in one performance category induces the appraiser to give correspondingly good or poor ratings on all the other performance categories. Central tendency. The employee's ratings on all performance standards cluster around the middle point of the rating scale. Although most people are average performance overall, most can also be differentiated along specific performance standards. Giving average ratings can be unfair towards outstanding performers. Leniency rating effects. The appraiser rates everyone on the positive end of the rating scale regardless of actual levels of performance. Strict rating effects. The appraiser rates everyone lower than their actual level of performance. Recency effects. The appraiser is influenced by the employee's most recent positive or negative behavior. Similar or dissimilar to me effect. People tend to like others who hold similar opinions, values, and attitudes and behave similarly under similar conditions. The appraiser may positively appraise employees who are similar to him or her and negatively appraise those who are different. Initial or first impressions. An appraiser forms an initially positive or negative impression of the employee and ignores any subsequent information that may distort that first impression. The ability to identify and define rating errors should minimize their occurrence. Raters should know that they could prevent errors by justifying and recording their ratings. According to Latham and Mann, appraiser bias can be solved by finding ways to increase user acceptance of the appraisal process, basing appraisals on multiple sources, and training observers not only to be objective, but also to coach employees throughout the year. Evaluating performance. Although many organizations say that they teach supervisors and managers in performance appraisal, they usually merely train them on how to fill in the performance appraisal form. Supervisors are instructed to make sure that the appraisals they give to their employees are normally distributed. This type of training is inconsistent with the goals of performance appraisal. Effective training should teach appraisers to increase their rating accuracy and not to distribute the ratings along a normal curve. Methodology of performance appraisal training. Case studies and video material of different jobs must be discussed with managers and supervisors, and they must prove that they can assess performance accurately. Adequate opportunities for practice must be given. Frequent discussions of ways to overcome rating errors take place. It is not enough to make trainees aware of rating errors. They must practice ways to overcome rating errors and should receive feedback on their performance. Inter-rater reliability in respect of different case studies should be determined to get the ratings to an acceptable level of accuracy. Special attention must be given to trainees that rate too high or too low. Training alone will probably not solve performance appraisal problems. Unless raters are motivated to use the system effectively, and unless they are given the opportunity for observing their subordinates' performance appraisal errors will not be solved. Activity 11.1. Performance appraisal training. Why would training in how to conduct performance appraisals be an important issue for organizations to consider? Sources of appraisal. Supervisors, peers, subordinates, and the employees themselves could be involved in the appraisal. Based on the work of Latham and Mann, the research findings regarding the different appraisers can be summarized as follows. Supervisory appraisal. A subordinate's performance tends to increase in years when performance appraisals take place. However, supervisors spend little time on the appraisals of their subordinates. Poor appraisals result when the supervisor had limited opportunity to observe the behavior of a subordinate, and when the subordinate is hostile towards the supervisor. The supervisor's role should be to gather data and to make a final decision about the appraisal of a subordinate after gathering data from multiple sources. Peer appraisals. Peer appraisal is regarded as a reliable source of performance information. Peers tend to place more emphasis on interpersonal relationships and motivation than on task performance. However, inadequate instruments are often used to do appraisals. They are seen as useful when they are done with behavior observation scales. Self-appraisals. There is a poor relationship between self-appraisals and appraisals of others. Employees tend to rate their performance more favorably than their supervisors. Cross-cultural differences seem to exist between Eastern cultures and Western cultures. In Eastern cultures, self-criticism is regarded as an important way to improve performance. It seems that individuals with a high self-esteem tend to seek self-verifying feedback, even if it is negative, while individuals with low self-esteem seek positive feedback. Subordinate appraisals. Anonymous feedback from subordinates tends to promote positive changes in the supervisor's behavior and performance. Subordinates who were not allowed to provide anonymous feedback viewed appraisals more negatively than those who were allowed to provide anonymous feedback. The performance appraisal interview. Effects of the performance appraisal interview. It is a demotivating experience for an employee to receive an unexpected negative appraisal rating. Research has shown that many performance appraisal interviews have the following effects. Employees feel more uncertain where they stand after the interview than was the case before the interview. Many employees evaluate their supervisors less favorably after the interview than before it. The interview is sometimes conducted in an authoritarian way, which is inconsistent with democratic values. The interview does not lead to constructive behavior change. Research shows that interview effectiveness will increase when the interviewer is approached in a problem-solving manner. This includes setting a climate in which the supervisor and subordinate discuss the performance goals and standards and the employee's performance relative to these goals or standards. A problem-solving approach encourages employees to think about their job problems in a non-threatening atmosphere and to provide their own solutions to encountered performance problems. Participation by the employee is one of the most important factors influencing the success of the review. Preparation for the performance appraisal interview. Evaluation should not be viewed as a once-a-year completion of rating forms. To help with this communication, the manager should hold an appraisal interview with each subordinate to discuss the appraisal and to set objectives for the upcoming appraisal period. Experts advertise that employee development and salary action discussions should not occur in the same interview. The effectiveness of the interview will be increased when the supervisor or manager prepares for the interview. Preparation for the interview includes reviewing the performance appraisal format. He or she must be able to explain the rating scales, how the ratings are derived, and how the numbers on the rating scales are related to performance standards used on the measure. The employee's performance. He or she must be able to answer an employee questions and to justify the rating given to the employee. Knowledge of the self. The supervisor or manager must review his or her own strengths and weaknesses in interacting with people, in particular the ability to give negative feedback in a constructive manner. Conducting the performance appraisal interview. There must be active communication between the manager and the subordinate about the performance of the subordinate. The following behavior may lead to effective performance appraisal interviews. Structure and control the interview. The purpose of the interview must be stated. Control over the interview must be maintained, and an organized and prepared approach must be shown. No interruptions should occur during the interview. The employee should be oriented towards future performance by emphasizing the development of strengths. Ways to accomplish performance improvements should be discussed. At the end of the interview, a summary should be provided of all the major points. Establish and maintain rapport. An appropriate climate for the interview must be set. The interview must be opened in a warm and non-threatening manner, and the supervisor or manager must be sensitive to the needs and feelings of the employee.